I mean, to me, Daddy Kev is sort of like the mayor of L.A. Like, he knows everybody, everybody knows him, and everybody knows him as the guy to go to if you want the perfect sound.
Cosmic Zoo, we moved in here December of 2012. That's when we got access to the building to kind of start rehabbing the space. I'd had another recording studio in Eagle Rock that was just very small, and James and I, Nocando, and I had already been working together at the studio, and we had already had the Alpha Pub offices downstairs, and a unit opened up in the building, and we decided that this was a good opportunity to reopen the studio in a larger fashion. But I think it's really too about having a place that can operate 24/7, having a place that people feel comfortable going to, central location. We're here in Atwater Village right here. It's a pretty easy drive for most people, really close to downtown. And I think that's, if you're trying to do a studio in LA, it has to be kind of centrally located.
Being in this neighborhood, Atwater, this is like a a gentrified like barrio, you know, and I feel like the soul of like old LA is kind of still here, even though it's like hipstered out. Like there's some kids walking by, it's like a little cholo kid and his like baby's mom, and she was like, they're like, oh, you guys do music up there, you know, make sure, you know, like, you know, you represent for Atwater. And I never felt that feeling here, because here to me, like being from South Central, like I always thought this was like Silver Lake, you know, but it's actually, this place has a soul.
I met Kev at Low and Theory. It's so simple. I had a buddy that just introduced me, said I made beats. Kev said bring a CD. I did. I played the next week with Daedelus and a few others, and I was shocked, you know, like a little kid, because I used to be in line all the time.
What I think makes what Daddy Kev and Nocando have done so unique and kind of impressive is that they have been able to do it from an independent level, and I think that's something Kev has done for a long time, dating back to Concrete Jungle. And if you look at Kev's career and if you look at Nocando's career, they both have been like, you know, like to use the LP thing, they're like independent as fuck.
And so far as how James and I run the studio together, it's just a lot of shared duties. He has a lot of projects he's working on at all times with Hellfire Club or with his own solo stuff. And I just like the idea of there being a lot of creative people here. You know, his own creative pursuits bring a lot of people through here. The engineering work that I'm doing bring a lot of people through here. And I just like the idea of how that all kind of collides.
My role in Cosmic Zoo Studios is a super simple one. I'm not a gearhead, you know. I like to record rap songs. I like to record vocals and stuff like that. So I let Kev really take the lead on that. And he's just more like grassroots marketing. I have a podcast called Shots Fired. And I was like, all right, cool. We're going to use my podcast as a marketing tool. So we're going to, you know, record here. And we're going to make mention that we're in the Cosmic Zoo Studios in Atwater Village. And it's going to be on the site. And it gets like fucking 65,000 fucking hits, you know, over the course of a quarter or some shit. That's 65,000 people that know about this studio, you know.
There's almost like two sides to Cosmic Zoo. There's the work we do for hire, and then there's the work that I do on behalf of the labels, like Alpha Pup, Brain Feeder, and Hellfire Club, where me doing the engineering is usually kind of built into the release, you know. And so far as the kind of things that we're recording down here, style-wise, I mean, most of it, you know, fits in the electronic or rap categories. There is quite a bit of jazz stuff that we're doing down here, just on the mastering side, on the recording side as well. There's an idea behind great independent music, and there's like a code, you know? And almost all the records I've been able to work on, they abide by the code.
Flying Lotus, you know, You're Dead. That was a great record that came together over here in its final stages. The Thundercat Apocalypse album. That was just a really emotional time. Austin had just passed. That record was really for Austin. Run the Jewels, too. Amazing. I got to know LP a lot better during those sessions, same with Killer Mike. We just had some great conversations that happened and some great music that came out of it.
Obviously, like, the Zach De La Roca shit was pretty tight. That was just that was a nigga we made it moment.
John Wayne's record, that was kind of a special one for me. That was me kind of getting back more into mixing. I'd been mastering exclusively for a few years, so that kind of got me back in mix mode. That was just a real intimate record. John, very hands-on. I like that when artists are taken seriously. The underground music is stronger than ever in Los Angeles. And I'm biased when I say this, I think Low in Theory has a bit to do with that, that we've tried very hard to encapsulate that. The direction we're supposed to be going, which is against the grain.
For a while there, Low in Theory was a space that you would go to hear bass reproduced from tiny laptop speakers, writ large. And now Kev has made a place where those sounds can like come alive in a fashion that spreads far and wide, and it's really important to have a place where that can actually coalesce. And you take a mind like his and get the people that he has regularly through this and then hear the records they're producing, it's incredible.
So when we talk about the studio, we always talk about the club, you know, because when he built that studio, he was like, I want to get rid of all the clubs speakers I have, because they're just sitting around. I was like, no, dude, we should put them in the studio so we have like a miniature version of what we have here. So when we mix the records, we'll know what they sound like on kind of a smaller scale. So when we bring them here, it'll sound exactly the same.
It's not just summing mixing. It's not just really boutique EQs or really nice compressors or analog gear from way back when. There's some other kind of gestalt happening. There's a group thought that's kind of going into things that's making so that the mastering that's happening here is beautiful. It's like real, it's the real art form being played out.
In terms of the mastering, I always heard Kev was amazing, and I'd always heard projects that he had mastered, but to hear him master one of my own and see the difference in what I brought him versus what came back, it was really special.
Working here on the records have been amazing. It's mainly the last one I put out was when it all kind of started and this place was going on, and yeah, it was beautiful. I got a chance to mix all over again here, and that's been just a whole kind of elevation for what I've been doing at home. And then him coming into master is just, it's, you know, crucial, I think. Yeah, it's evidential on the records, you can hear it. Well, I guess you can't hear my demos, but yeah, you can hear it.
Now, more than ever, you don't need a studio. All you need is a laptop. But that's home recording, you know? And it's a different type of professionalism. Like, I don't see this as being like a place for the underground, other than mastering, you know? You send your records here for Kev to master. And really, you're sending it for Kev's ears. You know, we have the SSL now, so that changes the game a bit.
We've tried to have a situation where we have very high-end gear, but available at a much lower rate than you're going to spend at, say, NRG or, you know, Ocean Way. A lot of artists can't afford $1,000 to $2,000 per day. So it's a lot more affordable for someone who has a bunch of stems together, they're ready to mix, or they have a bunch of songs ready to record, they can knock out a bunch in a row. This is a good option for them.
But what most artists that I'm noticing as I've been studio hopping and going around, they really appreciate like the cult studio culture.
Cosmic Zoo is where the best of the best that don't run with the majors go. People that don't have a management telling them that they need to record at some famous place with some famous old man who doesn't know anything about the dynamics that the Low End Theory movement brings to the table.
We've all kind of been living off of Low End Theory for a while. I think it's a great place to come showcase, but in terms of like creating and making new plans and making new bonds, you need like a studio space. You need some place people can come together and share ideas.
In the age of email and collaboration all over the world, it's very nice to have an authentic place where things can happen in one vibe, in one setting, and when you can hear it in the music. I mean, we've recorded records here that have been all contained in this room, and you can definitely tell when that happens. It just has a certain vibe. There's no jumping in the creation process from one place to another. It's all made here.
We try to exist as a platform for the city. Much like Low in Theory is a platform for LA, this, what we're doing here, is a platform for Los Angeles. And I really just hope that people realize that this is open to them, that this can be an option, and they take advantage of the equipment that we have here. Ultimately, we're trying to deliver something that you're not going to be able to do on a laptop. That is the big difference. I think most producers realize you get to a point mixing in the box and doing it all, you know, on a laptop, or and you hit that ceiling. You know, you can only go so far, and then you're hearing songs on the radio, you're wondering, okay, it's different. And what's different usually is an analog console, usually.